I love that. And getting to just enjoy the singing along with you and sharing together in this weekend has been a real highlight for me. And I just want to share with you a little bit of some things that I have sensed. And one of the reasons how we just love this church. My wife and I, Pamela, we were married on January 2nd, 1982. Right shortly after we had graduated from Baylor University and she was doing her master's work in speech pathology. I was working for the university, planning on going to seminary, and we were there in Waco, and we got married on that January 2nd, 1982. I was able to afford a honeymoon on the beach in January of 1982, on the Gulf of Mexico. That was about what we had. We had a borrowed condominium that was loaned to us, and when we went, we were the only people there. Go figure. It was 40 degrees outside. Nobody wanted to be at the beach. I had about $200 in my pocket because my father gave me some money so I could have a little honeymoon. And we came back, and we started our life together. Now, through the years, as a Baptist pastor, we made memories as we could. A lot of our vacations were spent going to visit family where we had free accommodations. And then as our kids got up and out, we had an opportunity. The Lord blessed us so that we would be able to finally take a trip like this. And in January of 2012, the Lord made it economically well that we could actually take this trip, and we came to Hawaii. We had always dreamed of that. It was our 30th anniversary. And after that trip, Pam looked at me and she said, "You've made up for the honeymoon. This is it." Well, we found this is just a wonderful place to refresh, to relax, recharge, spend time with the Lord in just a beautiful setting. And so we said, we want to do this again. And so we made plans, and about a year and a half later, we came in September of 2013. And on that trip, we extended it a few days. I only missed one Sunday at home for preaching, but we extended that trip just to have some extra time. And I felt in my heart, I want to add in this trip, in this time, I want to find a church that we can go and worship with while we're there. And we began to look through, and my eyes fell upon First Baptist Church, Pearl City. And we came on that Sunday in September of 2013. And when we walked up, we found that this church felt just like home. We had people who greeted us with a big warm smile. They were friendly. They helped us find a place to sit. They joined in. We ended up meeting your pastor briefly that day. And we left and we just said, that is a wonderful church. And all we'd like to do is just join in with them. And when we're here, maybe we could come and be a little bit of encouragement just for one moment. We came back then 2 years later in 2015. In those 2 years, our local church was in the process of relocating our campus. First Baptist Church, Grand Prairie. You wouldn't have to know anything about us. We're real close to Dallas and Fort Worth. We're right in the middle. We're a suburb city, but we have over 200,000 people. We're the 15th largest city in Texas. Our church was founded in 1880, and so we're a long-standing church. But in the last over 63 years, there have only been three pastors in that church. My two predecessors were 20-year pastors. I'm now in my 22nd year, and by God's grace, we'll continue going. And then I found out this church has a history of long pastorates. One of the things that says to me is that this is a mature church, a stable church that has a ministry and a vision, and they understand God's call to their staff, their pastors, and that was a real blessing. Well, in 2015, when we came, we were right at the point. We had just moved in to a new campus. where we are now center in our city. We're on a freeway that goes by with tens of thousands of people every day. It has opened up a lot of new ventures for our church family. But when we moved into that church facility, we had this beautiful worship center that we have windows on the side. You can see out. And on those windows, there are the motif of the cross. In the giant, they're really giant windows that look outside, but the glass panes, we made a cross in six panes, and we were here on that Sunday morning in 2015. We had just moved in, but I thought in the worship center, there's something just not right. There's something missing, and our baptistry had some beautiful tile on the wall, but we didn't have anything to put in the center. And we came that morning, and I looked back, and I saw how you have the cross prominently right in the middle. And I looked at the wood, and I looked at the shape, and in my spirit, I just said, that's it. That's what we need to put right in the middle. It'll complete it. So I went home, got online, I found a company that makes and cuts out by hand wooden crosses in exactly this shape. Ours is smaller because it's a smaller area. And if you ever go online and you'll see our worship center, you will see your cross at First Baptist Church Grand Prairie right in the middle. And I went home and I said, this completes this worship center. So I want to say thank you. Every Sunday, I preach in front of the cross, and we like to say in Baptist life, stand behind the cross, but it's kind of hard to do when it's on the wall. But we have the cross prominently. The cross is always bigger and higher than anything that we have. It's higher than the pastor. We will come and go, but Jesus Christ and the cross will always reign supreme. So thank you, Pearl City. Thank you for your inspiration. You have a part in what happens every Sunday in Grand Prairie, Texas. Now, last week, we had the joy of coming back again. And knowing we were going to have this, we made this a trip where we had our daughter and son-in-law and our two grandchildren came along. And when they came along and joined with us, our grandson is 7. Our granddaughter just turned 3 on December 28th. And while we were going around on the island and there at the resort, I found out her favorite song because she sang it everywhere we went. And it went like this. We wish you a Merry Christmas. We wish you a Merry Christmas. We wish you a Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year. And I thought to myself, we've just come through Christmas. That was a wonderful time. But when we got to the new year, it is tradition that people come to the new year, and when the clock strikes midnight, we sing an old Scottish song that was written many years ago, a poem and then set to tune called Auld Lang Syne. Auld Lang Syne. And Auld Lang Syne is a Scottish poem that speaks about, and it says, old long since, or of days gone by, and it talks about, in the poem, talks about some guys who got together and they talked about the previous year. Now, when I got to this year, I didn't really want to sing Auld Lang Syne about 2020. I wanted to sing a song that said, good riddance, goodbye. It's not been an easy year at all by any stretch of the imagination. But we have gone through that year, and God has done some things in our life. He never quit working. He never said, I don't know what I'm going to do. My goodness, I am surprised by what I see here right now. Our Heavenly Father had a plan. He had a purpose. And in the midst of all the circumstances that you and I go through, He is still at work. Our Bible study, winter Bible study, has been out of 1 John, 2 John, and 3 John. We covered 1 John on Friday night, Saturday morning, Saturday night. We have finished 1 John. which was a letter that John wrote, the elder apostle, wrote to churches in Asia Minor, particularly in Ephesus where he was. And John wanted them to have protection against those who were false teachers. He wanted them to have encouragement in their life in a very difficult time period in history. And he wanted them to understand that they had purpose and meaning, and God wanted them to be the very best that they could be. And so he wrote that letter. But then he comes and he wrote a second letter about the same time, around that time period, 85 to 95 A.D. I kind of cut it down in the middle and just assume it's somewhere around 90 A.D. And John now writes a letter to an individual church. He's going to call her the Dear Lady. And he writes this letter to an individual church, and I like to think of it, this now is a personal letter to one church, just like First Baptist Church, Pearl City, just like First Baptist Church, Grand Prairie. Whatever church you happen to be in, this is a letter that is written for you. And he began in his letter, and he spoke about to the chosen lady or children, I love in the truth, and he speaks to them about what he wants them to do. Now, this past year has been a tough year, and I'm glad that God had taken us through it, and the promised year with the vaccines coming, with the things that are doing, God, we're going to get back to a place where we can fully gather again. And for those of you that are at home, you have been so good and patient all through this year, and the day will be coming when you and our church, we can gather once again fully. But it's a joy to get to see some people here. I agree with Joanne this morning to do that. But you know, God never wants us, no matter how good the past year was, no matter how wonderful something was in the past, God never wants us to dwell in the past. He always has something in the future. The Apostle Paul in Philippians chapter 3, he said it like this, one thing I do, I don't consider myself to have taken hold of it, but one thing I do, forgetting what is behind and straining toward what is ahead, I press on toward the goal to win the prize for which God has called me heavenward in Jesus Christ. The letter of now, 2 John, is a letter that is going to talk about being faithful to the truth. That's what Paul was saying there. I'm going to press on to be faithful to the truth in my life. And John now is going to give us three ways that he wants you to be faithful in 2021 and beyond to the truth that God gives to us. And the first thing we're going to hear is that John tells the church, he tells First Baptist Pearl City, I want you in this year, I want you to commit yourself to live for Christ. I want you in your life to set your heart to live for Him. Look at verse 4, what John writes. And John says in verse 4, it has given me great joy to find some of your children walking in the truth, just as the Father commanded us. When John uses the word walking, he's talking about our life. He's not just talking about walking physically. The word walking speaks about our conduct. It speaks about our character of our life. And the tense of the word implies it's not just a one-time walk, but it is a walk of continuous action. It is an everyday thing. It points now to a pattern and a habit of life, that wherever I go, I am seeking to walk in the truth. And the truth is everything associated with Jesus as that is revealed in God's Word. In verses 1 through 5, John uses the word truth 5 times, over and over and over again. And when you think about the truth, you need to understand that the truth is Jesus, God's incarnate Word, and it is the Bible, God's inspired Word. Now, you and I are going to live for someone. We're going to live for someone, either someone on this earth, we're going to let them be our motivator for what we do, or we're going to live for ourself. And when a person lives for himself or herself, that person becomes kind of like that opera singer that always tunes up, and they tune up and they just simply start singing, me, 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 me. It's all individual. That's a very shallow life. You either live for someone on this earth, you live for yourself, or you can make the choice rightly before God. I'm going to live for my Savior. A challenge in my life that I'm going to walk for Jesus. Not just Sunday morning, but Monday through Friday, Saturday night, wherever I am going to seek to live for Jesus. One thing that we have shared, and I've mentioned it this weekend, but we always try to be conscious of the fact that when we go on a trip, when we go on a vacation, wherever we go, when I'm out of town, somebody at our home church has already finished their morning worship service. I had one of our staff members preach this morning in my stead. You know what? No one has written me and said, boy, we really missed you this morning. Now, they had a great worship service. I know they were just fine. We had someone in our church family who passed away while I was gone. The service that is going to be taking place, someone else can do. I can't be the on-site pastor while I'm away. But 24/7, I am a child of God. I am a follower of Jesus Christ. I need to know that wherever I am, God wants me to walk in the truth and to be faithful to the truth and to be open to opportunities that I can have that I can share the gospel. I'll never forget a few years ago, we had a trip and we were in Florida, and some of you now know from the weekend that I enjoy playing golf. I don't play a lot at home, so when I get on vacation, I try to play as much as I can, and then I found out that I have a compatriot in your pastor who enjoys it about as much as me, so I give him an excuse that he can help me to be encouraged, so he goes out and he is on ministry call when he plays golf with me. But a few years ago, I was in Florida and I was on a playing golf, and they matched me up with a young man from New York who was born in South Korea. And as we were playing along, I mentioned that I am a pastor of a church, and I know that South Korea had had many, many people become Christians. I was a Christian, and I said, I am curious, are you a Christian or still on the way? Because I know many people from South Korea. We had people in our church family, and I had baptized a man who had served in World War II, and he had in our fellowship. And the young man said, well, I'm actually not a Christian, but my wife is. I said, okay. And then we visited a little bit more, and I enjoyed the time, and I invited. His name, he said, was Chris. He took an American name, and Chris. And I said, you know, Chris, I'm going to play in two more days. If you're available, I'd love to play again. And he said, well, we're leaving town that day. We have a plane flight out. And so I said, well, okay, you know, but I've enjoyed meeting you and sharing. 2 days later, I showed up, and Chris was at the golf course. I said, hey, this is wonderful, and I'm glad to see you. How did you work this out? He said, well, when I got home, I told my wife about getting to play with you. And my wife said, go play again. Because she knew that I was a pastor. She wanted me to be with her husband. They changed their flight to later. He played, and we ended up going through that day, and I had an opportunity to then say, Chris, your wife wanted you to hear something. Would you let me tell you about how Jesus changed my life? And on a vacation, I got to share with a young man in New York and lead him to Jesus Christ. And let me tell you, that doesn't happen all the time. But it's only because I made a choice in my life, and it's not because I'm a pastor. We made this choice when we were teenagers It follows through in our life. Live for Christ. Live consistently for Him. Live in the classroom for Jesus Christ. Live at your workplace for Jesus Christ. Live in your community for Jesus Christ. In our home community, we have neighbors, and we have sought intentionally to try to develop relationships with our neighbors and to reach out to our neighbors. Live in your community for Jesus Christ. The Apostle Paul wrote in Galatians chapter 2 and verse 20, and Paul says, I have been crucified with Christ. No longer I who live, but Christ lives in me. And the life I live in the body, I live by faith. He says, I don't live for myself, but I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and He gave Himself for me. Now, that goes so far beyond anything in our life to live for Christ. When we were freshmen at Baylor University, we went to a BSU, Baptist Student Union. They've changed the name up now, but we went to a Baptist Student Union meeting. That's actually where Pam and I first met, and we didn't date until our senior year. But we were challenged. I went to a meeting where I was challenged by the BSU director, who challenged a whole group of young men. And he says, young man, I want to know, in the 4 years that you're here at college, are you going to invest your life or are you going to spend your life? When you spend something, it's gone. You might have a pleasure for a moment, but it's gone. But when you invest your resources, you have something that starts bringing dividends, and it lasts a long time. And I made a commitment even then in college, a fresh commitment. I want to invest my life. I want to live for Christ. I want to make a difference in this world. It is very challenging to do in the daily walk, but it is so freeing to live for Christ. So in 2021, I challenge you with the full assurance of faith to be faithful to the truth. First of all, John says, live for Christ. The second challenge John gives us in his letter is not only does John challenge us to be faithful to the truth by living for Christ, but then John says, I want you to love God's people. I want you to love God's people. Let's go to look at verse 5. John writes to this dear lady, the church, and now, dear lady, and that always is that local church that he's referring to, I'm not writing you a new command, but one that we have had from the beginning. I ask that we love one another. John is sharing that from the beginning, from the time that you heard the gospel of Jesus Christ, this is his word. I can picture that John is hearing Jesus saying a passage that we have shared and that you know, and we've heard it over and over and over again. In John chapter 13, verse 34, when Jesus said, a new commandment I give you, love one another. As I have loved you, you must also love one another, and by this shall all men know that you are my disciples, if you love one another. And how did Jesus love them? He loved them selflessly. He loved them sacrificially. He loved them with a heart to serve. For Jesus said, the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and to give His life as a ransom for many. When we picked a church that we would get to come and worship with and we looked through, we're kind of used to First Baptist churches. I've pastored First Baptist churches all of my life, so I understand a lot of the nature, I think, of the First Baptist church. That's something that I understand in my heart. Pam grew up at First Baptist Church in San Angelo, Texas, and one of the times, I think it was our first time when we were here, we actually, one of the members of your church, I don't recall, it might be someone sitting here, tell me later, actually had been stationed at the air base in San Angelo, Texas, in West Texas, in their earlier days. And so we have so much connection together. But the fact is, we grew up at First Baptist Churches. I like the name First Baptist Church. And somebody one time who was not a Baptist asked me if that was a franchise of churches. I said, no. All it means is that church happened to be the first one that was established in their particular community. So they chose the name first. And then after the one said second, then usually they quit deciding to be third, fourth, fifth, sixth, and seventh, and they took another name. We have a number of colleagues in ministry, Sterling and I, that are starting to go with their churches and take the name Baptist off of the name. Now, quite frankly, I do understand some of the context of why some are doing it. Because over the years, Baptists have not always had a good reputation of how the world ends up seeing us. We kind of have a reputation of arguing among each other, bickering, dividing, being judgmental as far as the world sees it, not understanding biblical principles. But that's kind of how the world sees it. I've always thought it was kind of interesting when one of our colleague churches, our sister churches, takes the name Baptist off. And I think, well, you're still Baptist. And when they come in the door, aren't you Baptist? So are you? Don't hide it. But here's my conviction. If our church, if your church here will live for Jesus Christ and you will love people the way that God loves people, with a service love, with a sacrificial love, with a welcoming love, with a love that says we accept you wherever you are, whatever you've done. We may not and we do not affirm sinful behavior, but we don't do it in ourselves. But we accept you and we don't care where you've been. We care where you're going and we want you to go and spend eternity with God in heaven. If we will love people like that, they'll draw. They'll know we're disciples. And the name Baptist will be a name that is recognized in their community. In our particular context, when we moved into our new campus, we began to say, we want you, if you are a school group, we want you to come and have your concerts in our worship center. And we're going to have people who are going to open the door. We're going to welcome you. If you are a community group, we would like to host if we can. And so our church family has hosted funeral services in our community. We've hosted concerts for our school children in different ways. And we've had thousands of people now come into our facility where they see the cross on the back wall, because I would never cover the cross. We have scriptures all around our building where people walk in. And what we want to be known as is the church that if you're having a struggle, if you have something in your life that you need, we want you to know that we care about you and we are good neighbors for you. We want to be the church that serves our community. And when you begin to be known as that, people say, oh, what church really helps people? Well, it's that Baptist church down there. And the name Baptist all of a sudden then becomes known and associated with good things. Listen, people don't care about our doctrine. They don't understand doctrine out in the world. They don't care about our programs. They don't really care about the technologies that we use. They don't care about the big crowds that we draw. They don't care about our facilities, but they will notice if we love one another. Now, they were not impressed with our buildings. They're not impressed with our budgets, though we ought to pay all our bills. They notice our relationships. So I challenge you in 2021, keep building those relationships. Invite people to come into your small group. Do all that you can to grow your Sunday school class one person at a time. Invite somebody to be a part of your group. Reach out to help, not only in your church, but reach out and find ways that you can continue to help in this community with that school right across the way. I know you do some things over there, but reach out in every way you can and let this community know. First Baptist Church, Pearl City, we love our city. We love this area. You are welcome here, and we care about you. Love God's people. and people will understand, and they will hear, and they will know, and you will see God work. Live for Christ. Love God's people. And then John gets to the final thing that really sums up one of the real reasons that he writes this letter. And he says to them, I want you to be faithful to the truth, to live for Christ, to love God's people, but I also want you to learn God's word. Let's begin. We see in verse 6 through 9, and John writes and he says, and this is love, that we walk in obedience to his commands. As you have heard from the beginning, his command is that you walk in love. And then John goes on and he tells us in verse 7, there are many deceivers who do not acknowledge Jesus as coming in the flesh. They've gone out into the world. Any such person is a deceiver and the Antichrist. Verse 8, watch out that you do not lose what you've worked for, but that you may be fully rewarded. And he tells us, and then verse 9, anyone who runs ahead and does not continue in the teaching of Christ does not have God, but whoever continues in the teaching has both the Father and the Son. John is telling us that we need to learn God's word, and learning God's word does a few things in our life. First of all, learning God's word gives direction for our life. John said in verse 6, I want you to walk in obedience to his commands. Now, over Christmas time, those of us who are parents and grandparents sometimes, we get a package that we get for our children, and it comes with a sign in said, assembly required. Now, when I see something assembly required, I kind of shudder a little bit, but at the same time, I'm a man. I can fix it. I can put it together. And so I don't always feel like I need the directions. I mean, after all, I can figure this out. Well, we just got one for ourselves. We have Christmas. We both have birthdays right after Christmas. We have our anniversary on January 2nd. They're all compiled. So this year, one of the things that we decided we were going to get for each other was an exercise bicycle. And we got this exercise bicycle. It came through the, not the mail, but it was delivered. It's in a box. I have to take it out. First of all, I figured I can take it out, and I was going to take the box upstairs where I was going to undo it. It was very, very heavy. Finally, Pam said, you know, why don't we undo the box and take it out by pieces? That kind of hurt my feelings that I didn't think of that first, but I did it. It was a whole lot easier. We got all the pieces upstairs where it was going to be assembled. And then I began to look at those pieces. I said, well, this doesn't look very hard. And so I started putting those pieces together. Why don't you take a look at the directions? Oh, okay, I'll look at a few, and then I'll get started. And then I started going along, and I thought I'm doing pretty good. And then I found some of the bolts going on, and they fit in one area. I got finished, and I had different color bolts, and I realized I put the wrong color bolts in the wrong places because I didn't follow the directions. And then there's another stand on the front of the bicycle. It had rollers on one side. I didn't look at the directions. I put it up. It fit in just fine. And then I wanted to move the bike, but I couldn't pick it up because the rollers were in the right place. I couldn't move it. I looked at the directions. It said, turn it around, you idiot. Well, it didn't say idiot, but that's how I interpreted it. I turned it around, and it just worked perfect. You see, if I had just started to follow the directions, it would have saved me time. It would have saved me frustration. It would have saved me doing something over again. I'm sure you've never had that experience. But the fact is that when I go through that, I've learned a little bit. Even though I don't always follow it, I've learned that if you follow the directions of the person who made this, it'll go a lot better. God created you. He knows exactly how to make things work. In Psalm 119, verse 105, the Bible says, your word is a lamp unto my feet, a light unto my path. I have taken an oath and confirmed it. I will follow your righteous laws.
The Word of God, when we learn it, it gives direction to our life. But the Word of God also gives protection to our lives. In verse 7 and 8, John speaks of this protection. And he tells the people, he says, many deceivers who do not acknowledge Jesus is coming in the flesh, they've gone out into the world. Any such person is a deceiver and the Antichrist. Watch out that you don't lose what you've worked for, but that you may be rewarded fully. Now, let's unpackage this. Antichrist here is not referring to the individual person that John will speak about by revelation a few years later. He's not talking about one individual person. He's talking about anybody in generality who is against the gospel of Jesus Christ and not teaching the truth that Jesus is God, come in the flesh, fully God, fully man, who lived a perfect life, died on a cross for our sin, buried in a tomb, rose to life. He lives today and offers salvation to anyone who will believe. What John is saying, you need to be aware as you learn God's word, it'll give you protection for your life. It'll keep you safe. And how can you discern error? Well, first of all, John says you can do what we call the lip test. That is, he says, anyone who denies that Jesus is come in the flesh, literally the scripture is Jesus Christ came in the flesh, that he wrapped himself up in human flesh, born as a person. Some of the heretics were saying Jesus was not either a real man. He only looked like a man, but he was just an appearance as a man. Others said that he was a man that the Spirit of God came upon at his baptism, left before the cross. And John is saying, no, that is not right. He's not just a good man. He's not just some prophet that God sent. He is God himself, wrapped up in human flesh, 100% man just like you, except that he did not have a sin nature. He experienced death. God did not leave at that moment, but rather he gave himself, and God sacrificed himself on our behalf to cover the sin of the whole world. One drop of the blood of Jesus was enough to cover all of our sin and save us and take us into heaven, but he didn't give one drop. He gave it all on our behalf. The lip test is, what do you confess? Jesus Christ is Lord. But he also says, take another test. Look at the life test. Examine the life. Watch how they live. Look at what they do. Follow them around. The life test in Matthew 7 tells us, by their fruit shall you know them. We're not anybody's judge, but we are fruit inspectors. In verse 8, John had said, watch out that you do not lose what you have worked for. That doesn't mean I can lose my salvation, but it does mean that if I don't watch out, I could in a moment, I could lose the effectiveness of the ministry that God has given to me, and I could ruin many things. It is so imperative that we watch ourselves in our life, that at any moment Satan looks how he could trip us up and make a mess of our lives and cause disrepute to the kingdom of God. So what God wants me to do is to hide his word into my heart that I might not sin against him. He wants me to live a life that is learning and that is following him. And then not only do I get protection in my life, I get direction for my life, but when I learn God's word, it gives me confirmation to my faith. In verse 9, John says, whoever runs ahead and does not continue in Christ, in the teaching of Christ, does not have God. But whoever continues in this teaching has both the Father and the Son. What he's saying is continues to remain in it, to end up living in it, to stay there on a continual action. And so John is giving to us protection. He's giving us direction. He's giving us confirmation for our faith. And he sums it up in verse 10 and 11 when he says to us, now don't welcome this kind of person. If this person does not have the lip test right, if they don't have the life test right, if they are not acknowledging Jesus Christ right, don't follow that teaching. Don't welcome them in. Protect yourself in the Lord. And then John sums it up in verse 12, and he closes out this letter. And in verse 12, John says, you know, I have much to write you. I don't want to use paper and ink. Instead, I hope I can visit with you. And I'd like to talk with you face to face so that your joy may be complete. It's been a real joy for me to get to do this. What I've just enjoyed sitting and worshiping with you. But I think one of the great joys of our vacation and for the rest of our lives as we come back, when the Lord allows us to come back to this beautiful place, will be to keep following and to pray and watch what takes place over the years with First Baptist Pearl City and get to come back and meet you and see you face to face. And I will feel that way. But in the new year, I challenge you, First Baptist Pearl City. I challenge you, as God is working, as you're beginning to now to start opening up again, as the pandemic is, by God's grace, is taken care of through the vaccines, through all the things, and eventually we'll be back to where we can feel like we can move around, where we can do more than fist bump one another, when we can hug one another and know it's okay. And the day will come. But as that day comes, you just keep on. You keep on loving one another. You keep on living for Christ. Keep on learning God's word. Build your small groups. Do your ministry. God has great plans for you. I want to ask you to bow your head with me. And this morning, some of you at home, as you've tuned in, if there's any of you right there where you are and you have not given your heart to Jesus Christ this morning, would you pray this simple prayer in your heart, just like Chris did that I told you about many years ago? Pray this simple prayer. Dear God, I admit that I'm a sinner. I believe Jesus died and rose again for me. I confess now that Jesus is Lord, and I receive you as my Savior. If you're making that decision right now, if you've prayed that prayer, I want to encourage you to call this church or write them through email. I promise you, Sterling, just like I would at home, Sterling will give you a call back. Some of you are believers. You live in this area, but you don't have a church family. Maybe you've let First Baptist Pearl City be the church that you worshiped at, you attend at times, even regularly, but you've never committed yourself to being a part of God's local church family. He wrote this letter for a local church. He wants you to be a part of a local family of faith. And if God's talking to you about nailing down that you have a local church body, you need to call again. Call Sterling. Call the staff. They will talk with you and they'll share with you the very simple way of inviting you to become a part of this family. Father, use this time. I pray your hand will rest firmly upon this local, wonderful church family. God bless them in all that they do. Use them. Speak through them. Touch them. And Father, I pray that those that are listening right now will feel a sense of encouragement in the word, because God, you are working very strongly in our lives. In Jesus' name, amen.